Good morning. It's great to have you with us this morning, at home, online, or here in the worship center. We would encourage you to continue to use our live stream service until you feel comfortable in joining us collectively for worship. We also would love for you to recommend our live stream service to a friend. For those of you that have decided to regather here at church, let's continue to work to keep everyone healthy. This includes the practice of physical distancing. Following the service, if you see a gathering of people at the exit, you are welcome to remain in your seats and depart the exit doors as they clear. Please refrain from handshaking and/or hugging, and we encourage fellowshipping with one another in the parking lot following the service. If you have a child that becomes restless, we have a room available in the children's wing for parents and kids under 3 years of age. Live stream will be available for you as you tend to the needs of your child.
We are super excited that we have two fun family activities for you this summer. The first one is called A Day at Camp, and I'll be taking groups of kids to camp according to their age for a one-day fun experience. The deadline to sign up for the first day at camp is today. So parents, if your kids wanted to come to the day at camp on Tuesday, make sure you sign up on the church webpage today. Go to the kids button and click on the sign up form. The second fun activity is our family VBS experience. We're gonna start the middle of July on July 15th, and every Wednesday night we'll have a fun family activity for you to do following our VBS curriculum. So we hope your family can join us. Again, sign up on the church webpage.
We know many of our students are missing camp and momentum this summer. In light of that, we are excited to announce a new event called Summer Connect coming July 14th through 17th. On day one, our senior high students will be traveling to Johnstown for a service project. On day two and three, all students in grades 6 through 12 will enjoy a day at the Martinsburg Park and then a day at Camp Manawagon. Each of the first 3 days will end with a chapel session, including a time of worship with a Camp Manawagon band. Finally, on day four, our senior high students are invited to an outdoor movie night at Ryan and Aaron Deedle's. For more information and to know how to sign up, please see the parents' Facebook page and the parents' email chain later this week. As part of our Sunday morning services on July 19th, we will be honoring our graduates. More info to come in the following weeks.
Thanks for worshiping with us this morning. For more information about the programs and ministries of Martinsburg Grace Brethren Church, please go to our website at mgbconline.com.
Good morning, everybody, and we want to say welcome to everyone joining us in our worship center or those joining us through our live stream option. And once again, we want to say good morning to everyone, but especially if you're our first time visitor, whether in our worship center or a first time visitor through our live stream option.
And we wanted to congratulate Dave and Judy Helsel on their wedding yesterday. That was very special. And they actually were here in the first service, so that was really, really neat to see them. And also, we want to honor our fathers today. I know we make a bigger deal about Mother's Day, but it is actually Father's Day, and we want to say thank you to our fathers. So thank you very much, and let's see what happens. They didn't get an applause either.
Yeah, they didn't clap either, but Ryan cut off my joke because he didn't like my joke earlier. But anyways, what else do we have going on? We are not passing out printed material at this time. All of our information can be found online. If you have not signed up for our weekly digital update, please go to the website to receive this valuable email.
And on Friday, we have our big bargain days here in town in Martinsburg. And I understand Curryville also will have their yard sales the same day. So they're always crazy when they're separate. But now we have the traffic patterns will be really crazy in town. But at any rate, we're having an opportunity to have some outreach here from the church parking lot. And if you'd like to help us, go to the website and sign up. We could use some help just handing out some things to the kids and just encouraging our community. And if you also want a table in the yard sale, we have those available too. Just go to the website. That's really, really important that you just keep visiting the website, especially at this time that we don't have paper distribution. Make sure you're checking out the website. And also our offering, just as a reminder, we have an offering box outside the center door. If you miss that box, you can. There's a box out here at this exit at the glass table, and you can just drop your offering in the box. It's kind of a little decorative box. You also are still able to send your offering if you prefer to do that, or if you like giving your offering online, that's fine too. You can continue to do that. And for those who are watching on live stream, they can give that way as well.
Please join me in prayer right now. Dear Father, we thank you for today, and on a day such as Father's Day, that we reminded that you are a heavenly Father, that you care for us, that you guide us, that you instruct us as a father should. We just pray as we go into this worship hour that you would be a true heavenly Father to us in this experience. We give this prayer in your Son's name, amen. So we're going to go to our call to worship from the Mills family.
Psalm 119:89-90.
Forever, O Lord, your word is firmly fixed in the heavens. Your faithfulness endures to all generations. You have established the earth, and it stands fast.
All right, let's stand and sing together. Arlen, were you clapping for that video? Thanks. I think second service is the more lively service. What do you guys think? You don't know. You weren't here first service. Don't tell the first service people I said that. All right, let's sing.
Attendeth my way when sorrow. Keep us day and night. We can all
Jesus, strong and kind. Heavenly Father, I pray in the midst of difficult circumstances that we will run to you, that we will hold firmly to the promises of your word. As we watch our world and our nation go through difficult times, Father, we pray that we will run to you, that the nation would turn its hearts back to you. Father, I just ask that your spirit would have free rein this morning. Convict us, move us, shape us, and change us. As we look at James chapter 1 and we talk about trials, tribulations, we talk about temptation and how we are to respond to those, Father, I pray that you will guide each of us wherever we are in our lives right now. Guide us to be more like you. We give this prayer in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. Happy Father's Day. Give us a moment as we kind of transition the stage here. Last week, we began our first in the series from the book of James, and we kind of introed things and laid things out and kind of explained what James looks like and gave kind of an overview of things. If you recall, one of the things I said, I used an illustration, James is a lot like duct tape. And if you're confused, that's okay. Duct tape is a highly relevant, valuable resource, multifaceted resource that you typically have in your home. And so we say that James is a lot like duct tape because James deals with a lot of relevant situations that occur in our lives. He confronts various aspects of our everyday ministry and everyday living out the kingdom of Jesus Christ. If you recall last week, I listed 10 aspects or 10 different things that duct tape can be used for, right? Do you remember that? And one of those was removing a sliver. Now, there's a multiple uses for duct tape, but one of them that I mentioned was removing a sliver. So I was going to put a picture of Ryan Deedle's foot up here because he sent me a picture last night. You know, when I was with the family, I got this picture pops up on my phone of his foot with a sliver in it. I didn't think it was a good way to open up with a sermon this morning, you know, seeing someone's foot with a sliver in it. But anyways, he tried the duct tape to see if he could get the sliver to come out. And I guess it kind of met with mixed reviews. It did kind of pull it a little to the surface that he could then get a hold of it. But what was better, he said, was that he used the duct tape in his shoe as a padding for his foot. So see, once again, an 11th creation of the use of duct tape, something else that you can utilize it for. Please continue to flood these in to Pastor Brandt, Pastor Darrell by email. Talk to them afterwards. They're forming a list, and so we want to make sure that you provide all of that. So apart from saying that James is a lot like duct tape, we also said James seeks to remind the church of Jesus' teaching on the Sermon on the Mount. What it means to be a Christian, a follower of Jesus Christ, and kingdom living. That's what Jesus went through on the Sermon on the Mount. And James takes some of those same issues, same things, and puts them in his letter to remind us. Last week, what we said is what we believe will be seen in how we live. What we believe will be seen in how we live. Today, we want to focus on this, though. Our response to trials and temptations impacts our lives. Our response to trials and temptations impacts our lives. And we're going to look at three aspects of James chapter 1. First, the Christian life will involve trials. All of us have gone through it, and all of us need to prepare for it. We will all go through trials. The Christian life will involve trials. Two, the Christian life will involve temptation. Becoming a follower of Jesus Christ does not exempt you from the temptations of the world. In fact, it will probably heighten those temptations. And thirdly, the Christian life will involve action. That is the theme of James, the entire book. That if you say that you're a follower of Jesus Christ and you believe and this is your faith, then it will be seen and will result in action. So let's dive in. Verses 2 through 3, James chapter 1. James writes, "Count it all joy, my brothers, when you meet trials of various kinds. For you know that the testing of your faith produces steadfastness. And let steadfastness have its full effect, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking in nothing." a couple key things to look at here. First of all, we need to define what a trial is. So for the simplicity of our focus this morning, a trial is something that impacts your life physically, emotionally, psychologically. It can come into your life and cause emotional pain, psychological pain, physical pain. That's what a trial is for our discussion here this morning. We can battle with depression, anxiety from a psychological, emotional standpoint, or physical. We've injured ourselves in some way. All of these things are trials that come into our life. The idea of here, though, that James writes to meet means literally to fall into. So you're walking along in the dark and suddenly you fall into a hole. It was unexpected. You weren't planning for it. You weren't preparing for it. You woke up that morning and the next thing you know, 2 hours later, bam, you're in the middle of this situation. You weren't expecting it. And that's what he means when you're going to meet these. You're going to fall into these trials. You'll also notice he says the testing of your faith produces steadfastness. Look, produce means a process. There's a process here that these trials just aren't in your life to cause you pain and suffering. These trials and situations and circumstances are there to produce something. They're part of a process. Notice he says that the testing of your faith produces steadfastness, a part of the process. And a part of the process of spiritual growth and maturity is testing. Now, don't look past that word, because testing here literally means the aspect of a silversmith purifying silver. Back in the olden days, when a person would get a chunk of silver in order to purify it, to bring it to its highest value, highest form, highest level of price, of cost, they would have to purify it. And what they would do is they would heat it. That's what a trial is. A trial is something that turns up the heat in your life. And so the silversmith heats that piece of silver and all of the impurities and the junk and the garbage comes to the top. And what does he do? He scrapes it off, throws it away. Then he cranks the heat up again and it brings the impurities to the top. He scoops them off and he throws it off to the side. He keeps doing that until he knows it's done and it's complete and it's pure. How does he know that? Here's how he knows. When the silversmith can look into the pot and see his reflection in the silver, he knows it's at its purest form. When we can look into our lives and see Jesus Christ, after he turns up the trials and its difficulties in our life to spiritually mature us, and we can see Jesus Christ and see how he's working in our lives, that's when we're becoming mature. And that's why he goes on to say that you may be perfect, complete, lacking in nothing. God uses our trials in our life to force us to him. He also uses difficult circumstances in our lives so that others can see our faith. Sometimes God uses those difficult circumstances to push our faith out into public view. We may not always like that, but sometimes that's what he does. That's how he works. The other aspect that James talks about is in the next verse here. I think it's the next one. Yes. James 1:5. If any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask God, who gives generously to all without reproach, and it will be given him. Sometimes the struggles and the challenges of our lives that we face drive us to prayer. They drive us to prayer. And here's the danger. The world will sometimes tell us that you can handle this on your own. You can deal with the situation on your own. And you don't go to God in prayer. And James tells us, listen, when you don't know what to do, when that situation is so big, when that death comes and somebody has announced to you and your family that they've passed, and you're in the midst of this struggle or that relationship, he says, and you don't know what to do, it's time to go to God in prayer. But often, what we do is we try to handle it on our own. And that's where it leads to temptation. So I think it's fitting that James would then go into a passage with respect to temptation. Look at verses 13 to 15. Let no one say when he is tempted, I am being tempted by God. For God cannot be tempted with evil, and he himself tempts no one. But each person is tempted when he is lured and enticed by his own desire. Then desire, when it is conceived, gives birth to sin. And sin, when it is fully grown, gives birth to death. Temptation is not from God. See, if God is in all power and control of all things, and God is the one initiating the temptation into our lives, then we don't stand a chance. But see, it's not from God. The passage clearly says that. The temptation lies within you. The temptation is our own heart, our sin nature, and Satan knows exactly what buttons to push with respect to our sin nature. He knows your weakness. He knows my weakness. And so therefore, he confronts those things. So that's where temptation comes from. It comes from within you. But don't miss these words here. But each person is tempted when he is lured, enticed by his own desire. Fishing terms. Now, I'm not a fisherman, but listen, the word tempted here in the original language literally means to trap or to catch. The idea of lured here means to pull an animal or prey out from its place of safety. That's what he literally means when he uses that word. And the idea of enticed means to place a bait before an animal, to seduce the animal or to seduce someone with bait. Now, again, I'm not a fisherman. Some of you are. John's back here. John Kime's a fisherman. So if you have any questions with respect to this, he can validate it, I'm sure. But there are basically three reasons as to why a fish will take or bite or go after a lure. Do you ever wonder? Some of those lures look pretty weird. You know, you go through Walmart, you look at them hanging on the display there. Why would a fish go after that? Well, there's three reasons as to why a fish would go after a lure. First, they're hungry. The lure looks like bait, something they consume, something they eat, and they're hungry. And so, bam, they go after it, they take the bait, and they're hooked. The second reason why is that they often get agitated. A lure that comes through their area can agitate them. Maybe it makes a sound that they don't like, you know, like a buzz bait or something like that. And it agitates them, and so they attack the bait because of agitation, anger, frustration, or they feel threatened. A third reason as to why a fish would take a lure is territorial. Let me explain this. I had, back when I lived in New York near Buffalo, we had ponds. And the bluegills would go in and they would clean out a little circular area with their tail. They would clear out in order to spawn to lay eggs. And so I would go in as a young child, as a boy, and I would take a lure and put it in the middle of where they had all their eggs. Now the fish, being territorial, wouldn't attack the bait. It would merely pick it up and take it outside of its egg bed, whatever you call that there, and drop it over on the side. Well, I would come back and put it back in there and the fish would come in, pick it up, carry it back outside. You see, they're territorial. They have an area that they want to defend. And so they would be territorial with respect to that. But see, in temptation, it begins in our heart. All of those things may be true, but it begins within our heart. That's where temptation is jump-started. It begins in our hearts, in our minds, and we think about it, then we take action, and we fulfill the desire, and it leads to death. Now, and sin, when it is fully grown, brings forth death. Interesting concept here again in the original language. The idea here is talking about a stillborn child. Now, think about this. James is saying, imagine a husband and wife having a child, the joy that that brings. 9 months, she carries the child. They're anticipating the joy and the excitement, the fulfillment, and then the baby is born and it's dead. It's a stillborn. He said, that's the same situation you have with temptation. You look at temptation, you look at the joy that it will bring you, that you think it will, the excitement of that, and then when you take action and you realize that it only brought about death and sin and anguish into my life. He goes on to say that the Christian life involves action. But be doers of the word and not hearers only, deceiving yourselves. For if anyone is a hearer of the word and not a doer, he is like a man who looks intently at his natural face in a mirror. For he looks at himself and goes away and at once forgets what he was like. But the one who looks into the perfect law, the law of liberty, and perseveres, being no hearer who forgets, but a doer who acts, he will be blessed in his doing. The idea of deceiving here means this, that you actually lie to yourself by rational reasoning. It's only used one other place in Colossians chapter 2. You lie to yourself by rational reasoning. That is, well, I can do this because everybody else is doing it. Or this will be the only time that I make this decision. Or these circumstances justify me doing this. We can rationalize to ourselves and come to a conclusion that it's okay to do it by deceiving ourselves rationally. That's what James is saying here. The other thing that he's talking about is that we need to look intently. Intently. That means to stoop down. It's like if you're walking through your house and you see a stain on your carpet or whatever, and you stoop down to see what it is. Oh, it's just a piece of lint. You have to get a closer look. James is saying we need to look intently. We need to stoop down and get a close look at what he's talking about here. And so we're going to just kind of quickly examine each of these and what is the right response as a follower of Jesus Christ to trials. What is a right response to Jesus Christ as a Christian with respect to temptation? The first one, a right response to trials develops spiritual growth and maturity. A right response to trials develops spiritual growth and maturity. Okay, I'm not saying that what we want to do is run around and look for problems and trials to engage in so that God can, you know, develop spiritual maturity. We don't want to create our own trials. It needs to be stated that James tells us to be joyful for trials. He does not tell us to be joyful for the trials, but to be joyful within them. Okay? I mean, it doesn't mean we go out looking for them, but they'll come to us, and we need to know our position within them. This is also not that we're supposed to be seeking them out. In addition to that, this doesn't mean that when we're in the midst of a difficult circumstance that we say, well, we're supposed to have joy so we don't feel the emotion of that. Certainly, if you have a loved one that has died and you're in a difficult trial of a situation, a time of grieving, and you're thinking, well, I'm supposed to be joyful, so that means I don't cry, that means I don't experience, that's not what James is saying. You're going to experience those emotions, and it's healthy that you do so, but he said, God is going to be working through there, and we need to keep our eyes looking for him and how he is going to be walking alongside us in the midst of those struggles. When we enter a time of struggle, often what we want to do is just get through it as quickly as possible. Doesn't matter, I want to do anything, just get from point A to point B. I just got to get this behind me. I got to put it behind me. I've got to move through this. Be careful. Because that's when temptation can rear its head. When we start to move through trials and start to put them behind us and do things on our own and not God's timetable and do things through our own ways and not looking for God and what he's working in the midst of that struggle, we have a tendency to take action on our own. And that can lead us right into temptation. Many years ago, there was a recruiting slogan by the United States Army. Be all you can be. Some of you remember that. Be all you can be. This is what James is referring to when in verse 4 he writes, persevering through trials will make us perfect and complete, lacking in nothing. Perfect and complete, lacking in nothing. The soldier comes in and commits to the military and commits and goes to basic training. putting them through themselves, through struggles and trials of all different times, tests in all different ways, physical tests, emotional tests, having a person get in your face and yell and scream and swear at you or whatever and just calling you different, putting you through all of this in order for you to persevere. And you go to boot camp and all of the various tests. And the soldier does this with a group of individuals because they need to rely on each other and encourage one another and support one another. Amazing. As men and women go into the military to become all that they can be, those tests help develop the best possible soldier for the United States Army. The end result is to be the best possible soldier. Let me explain it this way. Let's assume you're an athlete. You're a basketball player, or a volleyball player, or a high jumper, a high school high jumper. You need to be able to jump as high as possible. You need to be able to generate as much force and power from your legs and your body to jump as high as possible. One way to do that is through what we call box jumps. So the person will stand before a box, swing their arms, and explode and jump up onto the box. You thought I was going to do it. I'm not, because I'm afraid that box will slip and it'll slide out and I'll end up falling down. But they will jump back and forth, up and down, jumping up both feet and then back down on the box. Eventually, what they need to do, though, is they need to move to a higher box. They need to explode higher and jump up higher. I was in the gym one day, and there was this guy. He was jumping up on a box. It was almost as tall as he was. I mean, it was up towards his shoulders, and he would literally explode and just leap up onto that box. There's a point, folks, where the challenge of the box jump isn't as much physical as it is mental. So the guy goes over and he's going to jump up on the box and it's way up here. And he says, I know physically I can do it, but if I don't make it, I'm going to fall and get hurt. If I don't make it, I'm going to catch my foot and fall, maybe break my arm. And it becomes a mental, emotional thing. See, that's what God is doing in the process of our trials and tribulations. He says, listen, I'm trying to prepare you complete, mature. I'm trying to complete you in your totality to be able to face the next struggle. You've seen me help you through this. You've jumped on that box before. Let me take you to the next one. Let me purify you even more as a follower of Jesus Christ through these challenges. Another reality of these challenges and trials that we face in our life is that we learn through them so that we can go and help and assist other people. So we can live through those trials, see what God did, and then help others through the struggle. Some of you have done this past week, and I know that you have because I saw you do it. I heard about you doing it, helping another person through the struggle this week because you yourself have gone through this, and now you're coming alongside to help another person. What did you learn from being confined at home for those weeks? Through the trial of doing that, what did you learn? What will you share with others? What will you share with your children and your grandchildren 15 years from now about shelter at home and home confinement because of COVID-19? What will you share with them? What did you learn? Did you learn that some of the things you thought you desperately needed, you really could do without? Some of the things you thought life depended upon and just made life so much better, you know, we really don't need all of those channels on our cable. Maybe you realize some of those things. And so those are the things that you will share years from now. You go through trials and struggles and circumstances to learn and to be shaped by God. And in turn, you come alongside another person that might be going through a similar or the same struggle, to love them and care for them and help them proceed through that struggle. Finally, persevering through trials helps us to see God more powerfully and more clearly. I don't know about you, but think about it. There's probably a trial or situation that has popped in your head at the very beginning of this sermon. A struggle. Maybe it's a relationship struggle. Maybe it's a work struggle. I don't know what it is, but there's probably something that triggered in your mind and you're somewhat focused on that particular trial. How is God working in the midst of that? How have you seen him work? What power has he demonstrated to you through this whole process? Because after we come through this, you go through that difficult season, you will see how God held you and how he promised to walk through that and how he did walk through that situation with you. So, what's the right response to temptation? A right response to temptation solidifies our identity in Christ. A right response to temptation solidifies our identity in Christ. When you give in to temptation, sometimes what Satan does is he causes you to think in your mind, you know what, Brian? Maybe you're really not a Christian. Maybe you're not the follower of Christ that you thought you were. I mean, you gave into that temptation. Maybe you really don't have the Holy Spirit within you. And so you start to think through that. You start to wonder about that. That is Satan's way of tempting you and distorting the truth, because that's what temptation is. Temptation is a distortion of the truth. Look at Genesis chapter 3 in the garden. Look at Jesus' temptation in the Gospel of Matthew. Isn't that what Satan did? Let me distort the truth to you. Let me try to help you see it the way it really is, Satan says. And he twists and distorts the truth. So it would make sense to me that one of the best reactions that we can have with respect to temptation is, do you really know what biblical truth is? Do you spend time reading God's word to know what truth is? So that when you're confronted by Satan and the lie, that you know what truth is. Are you worshiping regularly with God's people? Surrounding yourself and listening to sermons and surrounding yourself with people that can help support you, help hold you accountable? Are you in a life group? Are you in a Bible study group? All of those things are truths of God's word that can help to protect us and take us through those times of temptation. Remember our fishing analogy. A territory of the mind. Fish will take the bait sometimes in order to protect their territory. How much are you protecting the territory of your mind? What are you allowing the world to put into your mind and into your heart? Are you doing your due diligence to protect that territory of your heart? Are you surrounding yourselves with others to hold you accountable and keep you where you need to be? Fish bite because they are often hungry and they see something that they want and they go after it. How often and how many times will you let the lure of temptation continue to go in front of you when you could very easily move yourself away from it? How often are you going to submit and protect subject yourself to that temptation when you could eliminate it? When you could move from it, just like Joseph and Potiphar's wife? Remember, Potiphar put Joseph in charge of his home, and his wife was there, and she wanted to commit adultery with Joseph and seduce him. And one day she grabs him by the coat, and what does Joseph do? He's out of there. He removes himself from the situation. If you think you can sit there and you can just continue to allow the temptation to flood you, Satan is more powerful. He's going to continue to press. He's going to continue to press if you allow yourself to be subjected to that. Trials can be navigated with joy when we remember that they are the soil in which we grow as Christians. They provide a unique means for us to grow and to understand God. Temptations are a distortion of the truth. Satan would seek to have his own way in our lives, and he distorts the truth before us. We need to know the truth of God's word. We need to surround ourselves with others and the support of others. Be careful that we don't permit certain things into our heart, into our minds, that can submit us to temptation. Do you know what your greatest temptation is? If you don't know what your greatest weakness is, Satan definitely does. Do you have a strategy when that's placed before you, whatever it might be? Do you have a plan as to what to do? Or all of a sudden are you just there and there's the temptation and you haven't really thought about it? If you know where your failures are and where the temptations are most likely to subject you, do you have a plan in order to stay away from that, to move through that? What's the triggers? What's the step? James closes chapter 1 with this verse. Religion that is pure and undefiled before God the Father is this, to visit orphans and widows in their affliction and to keep oneself unstained from the world. Religion here purely means external ways to demonstrate God. External ways that we serve God. Outward service to God. That's what he's talking about when he refers to religion. He says we're to be remain unstained by the world. Romans 12 talks about being transformed. Don't conform to the world, but be transformed from it. I fear that in our culture and our society today, we are so often sucked into the world's point of view, especially now. There's a lot of varying truth out there. We must be careful. The world has a tendency to pull us towards favoritism. The world has a tendency to pull us towards partiality, towards racism. All of those things James will confront in chapter 2. As he talks about partiality and how the Christian is to deal with those feelings and deal with the world's influence towards treating certain people more important than this person over here because of their wealth, because of where they live, because of the color of their skin. And Pastor Brandt's going to deal with that next week as we move into chapter 2. So here's my challenge for you today. Remember I said last week, James is an in-your-face text. It's an in-your-face book, and that's why we like it. We want something there to challenge us, and it's highly relevant. The challenge is to read James chapter 2 in preparation for Brandt's sermon. Then I want to ask you this. How is God using my current trials to shape me more like him? How is God using the circumstances of my life, the trials of my life, to shape me and change me and make me more like him? What is God doing in the midst of this struggle? Two, what is it that I need to remove from my life that is the lure or the temptation for me to sin? What is it in my life that entices me to sin? And what is it that I need to do or remove in order to pass through that temptation? What is it that I know God has called me to do or to take action in that I have been hesitant or resistant to do? What is it that God has called you to do? Or who has God called you to interact with? Or what does he want you to do in the next step that you've been hesitant or resistant to do? This is when we answer the question, do I have a faith that works? This is where the rubber meets the road, because James warned you. James warned all of us. Don't be a hearer only, but be a doer. And you and I have just sat here and listened to the word of God, and he has told us what we need to do. Now the question is, will we just say, yes, I have faith, this is truth, all these words are good, but then we don't go and do it? You see, again, I warned us, these are hard words to hear. Maybe God is calling you to seek reconciliation with that person, and you know it's true. You know Jesus taught it, but it's tough to act upon. You know that person needs help. Well, that's why we have a pastoral staff. They can go deal with it. Or they probably have family that can help them. Or I'm sure that their coworkers know that they're struggling through this, and God is calling you to take action. You see, faith means that we believe in something and it produces action. And if we don't, perhaps that faith is dead. You'll engage something this week, and God is calling you to take action based upon what you believe and that you are a follower of Jesus Christ. That's why James wrote this letter. You see, if you have faith, it should work. Father God, thank you for your word. None of this we can do on our own, Father. In fact, oftentimes when we try to do it, we just make things worse. We need to have the power of your Holy Spirit. We need to have you indwelling within us. We need to know the truth of your word. We need to surround ourselves with others that can hold us accountable, Father, and to push us through. We need to have a strategy and a plan for temptation so that when we're confronted with it, it's not just all of a sudden. We need to understand that trials will come. And that these are opportunities for your soil to produce growth and maturity within us, Father. You've called us not to be hearers only. You've called us to be doers. I pray that as we walk out those doors today, that we didn't just hear something that was true and we didn't just believe in something, but that belief will produce results, will produce action, will produce movement and motivation on our part, Father. The world is looking for salt and light. The world is looking for something different. And the gospel of Jesus Christ is within us. But is the world seeing it through what we do? I give this prayer in the name of your Son. Amen.
Please stand.
Every hour I need.
Oh God, how I need.
Father, as we face trials and difficult circumstances this week, some have been convicted here this morning as the Holy Spirit has spoken within their heart to make changes, to take action. We need you, Father. I pray for an empowerment of the Holy Spirit and an anointing of the Holy Spirit that would enable us to do what you have called us to do, to put our faith into action. Father, for those that are going to be confronted, as all of us are, with temptations of various kinds this week, I pray that we will have a knowledge of the truth, and we will have a strategy so that when Satan confronts, we will be able to respond with action, Father. I just pray that as you put people before us this week that need us, that need you, and you have called us to take action, that we will be found faithful. We give this prayer in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.